I'm Annabel. I'm British. You can hear by my accent. Thank you so much, Gillian, and thank you so much to Laura and Rugby for having me here. So I'm just a short story about my how I was brought up in I was actually brought up in Scotland. Have we got a picture? That house belonged to my mother's side of the family. It's in a very bleak, remote area in southwest Scotland. The original house, you go on to the next bit, looks something like this, without all the Victorian mess on the side. Probably dates back to about the 13th century. And then it just got messed around and lots of bits and pieces have added onto it over the years. And then we were living in quite a nice, comfortable suburban house in Hertfordshire, which is in southwest England. And my mum had this mad idea where she wanted to go and live out her childhood dream to go back and live in Scotland. She saw this in a paper and bought it for £80,000 in 1978, 1979. It had dry rots, it was damp, it was pretty depressing, basically. And we all arrived there as a family, and we were quite excited by the turret. it was like, who gets the bedroom with the turret? It had no central heating, and it was basically incredibly uncomfortable, but quite romantic to live in. But the winters were pretty bleak. It did not have tight box syndrome. It had a lot of so it was an interesting childhood. But all of us as children had, my two brothers had asthma, hay fever. We were all quite ill. We had sort of food allergies and anything that sort of ferments, like milk or dairy or wheat. We were sort of seen to be. All of us had a milk allergy, for instance. Actually, my mum was an interior decorator, so she did make over the years. We didn't have very much spare cash, but she did make it a lot more comfortable and put central heating in and wood burning stove and things like that. So it became a much nicer place to live. Has anyone seen Skyfall, James Bond movie? That's what the countryside is like there. It was something between like that and living in the Harry Potter Weasel house. Nothing quite sort of worked. It turns out it had lead pipes. My older brother had really bad glandular fever and was really quite ill the whole way through his 20s. He was unable to work. You just don't think about these things when you're a child, about how that could be affecting you. I then went to Edinburgh University and I studied history of art and theology, and then I left and I went. I wanted to do what my mum did and make historical houses look beautiful. So I did that, and then after that I became an art restorer, and that would seem like a romantic, interesting thing to do, but I spent a lot of time up scaffolding in the middle of nowhere in anorak on my own, breathing in ceiling moulds, and I really began to feel really unwell by the time I was 30. And then I changed direction. I did an interior design diploma, and then I was able to combine up my art restoration knowledge and my interior design knowledge and do up traditional country houses, a bit like this one that I was brought up in, and restore houses. But I realised that a lot of these old houses have all sorts of things wrong with them. Damp, dry rot, moulds, I think, are a really big thing. And I got iller and iller and iller in my 30s, to the point that I had all those symptoms that you were talking about, Gillian, like terrible sinus problems, dry eyes, just coughing. I just felt really tired, chronic fatigue syndrome. And I didn't get any post-viral thing, probably. I just got iller and iller, to the point that I had to really give up work. for a bit. And then the final nail in the coffin is when I had some dental work done. I had like 8 metal fillings, and I actually decided to have them all taken out. And a lot of people who have their fillings taken out, because I'd heard that heavy metal poisoning was a problem, and I actually had my blood tested, and I had something like 100 times over the legal limit of mercury, copper, and lead in my system, which is really quite scary. And a lot of it just gets into your cells. It doesn't even come up in your blood. And I think it just tipped me over the edge. I had all sorts of horrible things, like scabs around the back of my neck, not being able to open my eyes for weeks. I still to this day have problems with my hearing. I've always wanted to do something. I wanted to get well enough to be able to use my experience to do something better and to share with others how I overcame it. So I kept on determining this. Ultimately, I did a lot of it. I changed my diet. I don't eat wheat, sugar, or dairy because they're all quite fermented foods. And the thing is, when you get heavy metal poisoning, your body does weird things. Like it creates a lot of candida, which I think actually is trying to save you from the toxicity, but then it becomes a problem in itself. So sugar is a really big problem, and going back to kids with autism, and my sister-in-law teaches autistic and dyslexic kids, and one of the first things she asks kids when she's beginning to teach them is, what's your diet like? What do you eat? And nearly always they eat a lot of wheat and a lot of white bread and sugar. In Scotland, there's this terrible drink called Iron Brew, which is something between like Lucozade and Red Bull and Coke. Full of caffeine and sugar. And they all walk down the streets with fish and chips and this Iron Brew. Just taking the holistic approach, I wanted to do something more in interior design to take more responsibility and use natural products, but I wasn't really quite sure how to go about this. So I think sometimes when you make a determination or a vow or you've been through an experience, sometimes the universe responds and you get what you want, or you meet the person that you want to meet in order to get you to the next stage so you can create some value. Strangely, when I lived at this house, it was in the middle of nowhere, and I had to go back. I went back to live there when I wasn't very well for about a year, and I rented out my parents' stable flat. And I just went on sort of raw food juicing diets. I totally tried to do a detox and clean my system out, and it all really helped. But at the same time, I was like, oh, what can I do up here that's useful? Because it's so kind of, there aren't really that many jobs in Scotland. The Scots are not very, even if they've got money, they don't really like letting go. So they like spending it on hunting, shooting, and fishing, or something like that. And then suddenly, there's this big country house, which is close to where my parents live, called Dumfries House, which is a lovely big Georgian house. And it's about 4 or 5 miles down the road, and it was about to be sold. It was one of those country houses which was about to be sold for nothing. And it had this beautiful Chippendale furniture range there. And it was on its way down the motorway, and Prince Charles famously saved this unique collection of Chippendale furniture. And which is like worth 20 million in itself. It's worth more than the house, but he also bought the house, and it became part of the Prince's Foundation. And they have all sorts of really great courses there, like dry stone walling, and they do lots of great things, the Prince's Drawing School. So it was really great to see this country house flourish and for people to really enjoy it in the area, because it's quite a sort of run-down ex-mining area, and it's brought loads of kind of tourism to the area. And I was asked to do the show house in the village, because Prince Charles has quite traditional taste, and that's kind of been my background. It's a healthy eco village, which is built in healthy natural products. And it's one of his demonstration villages, but they are actually also selling the houses as well. And it's been done in a traditional Scottish way. And I did it in sort of local traditional Scottish product. Then that led on to me doing three more healthy homes for the Princess Foundation at our equivalent of High Point, which is called the Ideal Home Show. Not quite as classy, actually. It's kind of quite sort of middle of the road. But it had these three houses that they exhibited there. And then that's led on to me doing the preliminary designs for the Natural House. So I'm now kind of on the path that I always wanted to be on, which is great. And then I got introduced by Ben Bulgar, who's senior director, who Laura and Gillian and... Have you met Ben? I was at university with him. He's one of my best friends. And it just so happens he's also senior director of the Princess Foundation and was educated in architecture. And he got me to meet Gillian at the Princess Foundation, and she came to teach me the Wellness Within Your Walls course so that I could oversee this natural house with Gillian and relaunch it with sustainable natural products in it. So that's basically, we immediately hit on, and I told her, you know, I've actually had a really bad health issue myself, and this is so great that I've met you, because we don't have anything like this in the UK. We do have people wanting to build eco houses, but they tend to be quite sort of modern and quite space-agey in their individual houses that go on the TV on a programme like, we have something called Grand Designs in the UK. And you get sort of one or two sort of bespoke houses, but there's, apart from the Princess Foundation and Bray Building Research Establishment, there are no developers doing kind of like big villages in healthy products. So it's just great to know what you're doing here. And Gillian asked me to be the UK ambassador, and I was like, oh wow, my goodness. So it's a really great honour, and I'm still in the very early stages. I there's a lot I need to learn, but I feel it's now going to happen. This kind of I'm definitely going to be doing my job and take what I learned from Gillian back to the UK and try and connect. It's all about connections, isn't it? Connecting people up. So I wonder if I've missed anything out. My final thing I wanted to say. I personally think we all deserve to live in places that are non-toxic, natural, breathable, as you've said all this, as possible, and to love where we live. We have a beautiful planet, and yet many people are destroying and disrespecting it. And in my personal view, the world is actually responding with anger. You know, I think earthquakes and hurricanes are not just a natural phenomenon. Like, you know, climate change is a really serious problem. It's a real serious issue. I think if we all in this room make a positive vow from the heart with right intention, that the universe will respond in a positive way. So it's about respect.